Brother Rollins, Videos for Christ, spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ through social media, videosforchrist.com. Brother Rollins, Videos for Christ.
James chapter 4 and verse 7, the Bible says, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Today I want to talk about no. The Christian life, for many of us, we know, is characterized by a series of run-ins with the devil. Many of you can testify that since you've been saved, the devil has picked you out to pick on you. And if you are not having run-ins with the enemy, perhaps you and the devil are running in the same direction. As somebody knows that when you turn your life over to the Lord and you are committed to doing those things that are pleasing in God's sight, the devil will do everything in his power to try to derail your destiny. As a matter of fact, it is true that the closer you get to God, the greater the temptation from the enemy. Paul says in Romans 7:19 that when I would do good, evil is on every hand. And so if many of us were honest today, we'd have to be truthful and declare that it is difficult saying no. I mean, let's be honest. It is easy for us to say no, but to have the character behind no, to sustain a lifestyle that is consistent in what we say it, that's the challenge. And so I want to talk about this today because I believe that when you begin to look at your inability to say no, you realize that perhaps it has cost you God's best for your life. When you really reflect over your life and you begin to look at history and you begin to look at destiny, imagine how the world would have been different had some people just said no. Could you ever imagine what the world would have been had Adam and Eve said no? Imagine, women, you would have never had childbirth pains, cramps. Men would have never had to work as hard as we have to work if only they had said no. What would life have been like had not Samson, if Samson had learned how to say no? What would life have been like had David said no? No. What would history record regarding President Bill Clinton had he said no? Would the Falcons be in the Super Bowl this year had Michael Vick said no? Just look down your row on both sides. There are people that are looking a little uncomfortable now because they're thinking over their life now, thinking, wow, what would my life be if I had said no? I mean, when you look over your life, it can be very painful, a sobering reality of where you could be if you had only said no, because a lot of the pain and the drama that we have experienced in our lives is a result of us not being able to say no. Why is it so difficult to say no? The church teaches us. I mean, the church is good at preaching at us, telling us what we ought not do. We ought not do this, ought not do that, ought not do that. But nobody ever tells us how not to do it. Paul says, I have the will to do a thing, but nobody tells me how to do the thing. So consequently, I'm ended up struggling in my spirit. There is a civil war going on inside of me. I theoretically know that I should not do a thing, but practically nobody's given me the skill set to show me how not to do it. And so I believe it's important, people of God, that you've got to have spiritual discipline and fortitude to say no. And this is why James encourages the body of Christ by opening up by saying, submit yourselves unto God. God, then you can resist the devil and he will flee from you. When you will submit yourself unto God, you are literally coming under God's authority. You are standing under the authority of God. Standing under the authority of God. And whatever you stand under is what you understand. And it is important to get this, people of God, because there are many people who want to hold on to their own will and never submit their will to God. But the only way you're going to get the victory, you have to say, God, I exchange my will for your will. I lean not to my own understanding, but in all my ways I acknowledge you. I'm preaching this message today because God wants to do some great things in your life and in your ministry, but it's going to be hinged upon your ability to look at some stuff, that every attack of the enemy, overtly and covertly, and look at the devil and say, no, you will not have my destiny. No, you will not have my family. No, you will not cause me to play myself. No, I'm not going down that road another year. No, I will not do the mistakes I did last year. Somebody will declare no in this place. So I want you to get this. I have not come to shout you. This is a message. I have come to make you pay attention. Because there are many of us who come to church every year. We shout, we give God glory, we fall out under the anointing and all that. And we know how to say no at 10 p.m. But by 2 a.m. we saying, yeah, yeah. Somebody got to help us with this thing. Too many fallen soldiers in the body of Christ. Somebody got to speak to what's going on. Why is it so hard to say no? Well, we have to begin now examining the complications of the devil. I mean, let's be real. If you look at the success of any particular football team or any particular basketball team, what they do before they go into the game, they study their opponent. They study film. They study tape. They do their homework. And so if you're going to deal with this, you got to study how Satan has worked throughout biblical history in order for you to understand his schemes. Because the devil is subtle and he is determined. And James says, resist him. Now watch this. Now you got to be aware, because what happens with the devil, I want you to get this, is that the devil loves to get you by yourself. That's why when you go through, he always pulls you by yourself. I don't want to be bothered with anybody. Leave me alone. I don't want to talk to nobody. I don't want to go to church. I just want to be by myself. I be in God. You just lying. It's just you, because you want to be by yourself. Because what happens once he pulls you away from church and pulls you away from the people of God, isolation sets you up for demonic interrogation. So watch this. Watch this. So what happens now? I want you to really get this. Is that there are no exemptions from demonic interrogation. I don't care how big your Bible or how many tongues you speak in. All of us in here know the devil will come. Now here's the deal. If he's coming, how does he come? The Bible says, listen, he doesn't come looking like you think he comes. You have these iconic figures of Satan, you know, with the pitchfork and the tail and all that. That ain't how the devil comes. He comes. The Bible says it's an angel of light. He comes. Looking like things you like. I'm gonna preach this in here. We're gonna see who's gonna run today. He comes with that which is appealing. He will not tempt you with things that are not appealing to you. He knows how to package the exact thing that triggers your weakness. See, I wish I could like really say what I want to say. No, I can't. No. So I'm going to redact it. I'm going to edit it because I'm in the house of God. But let me break it down. But you read between the lines. There is a difference between heck no and no. Heck to the no. And no, see, I can't even say it like I want to say it. Some of y'all feel me, yeah, yeah. See, because heck no, it's easy to resist. That's when some temptation comes in your life, you're like, you gotta be kidding me, whatever. You wouldn't have a chance on my weakest day. You blow it off like, you gotta be kidding me. That's your best shot. That's when the devil goes to his third string. You're like, but what do you do when the devil pull out his first string? When he brings something that challenges the very fiber of your faith. You see, you gotta understand something, people of God. Listen, the devil has a strategic plan to try to take you out. Remember this, the Bible says he comes to seek to kill, steal, and destroy. So before you resist him, you gotta know how he's coming. What he's gonna do, first of all, he wants you to know, I'm aware of your taste. I know what you have a taste for. I know what you like. You know, you sit in a restaurant trying to eat healthy, you know how much you love peach cobbler, know how much you love chocolate cake. You're like, I'm done, I'm good, we'll have no dessert. No, no, you gotta at least see what we have. No, we're fine. And they bring you this big old tray, you're like, oh God. And there you are. Okay, we'll just have a little piece. Touch your neighbor and say, a little piece can get you in trouble. That's another sermon, though. That's another sermon. Some of y'all can testify. I know the danger of a little piece. Knows your taste. And so once he knows your taste, then he packages the temptation. See, to be tempted is not the sin. But it is the presentation of the taste. It is the manifestation of your taste. That's how temptation shows up. He packages it in such a way where it is palatable to you. Everything doesn't turn your head, but he will bring temptation that'll make you look twice. And then once the temptation comes, it then begins to point to deeper issues called your tendencies. Because remember now, when you read in Judges, when you get home, you read Judges 14, 1, 2, and 3, Samson had a thing for Philistine women. His daddy said, boy, leave those women alone. You need to hang out with women over here. But Samson said, no, daddy, go give me one of them Philistines, because I like them Philistine girls. And said, what happened? When they got ready to conspire against Samson, they knew his tendencies. See, you have to understand something about tendencies. See, tendencies are like when you understand sin. Sin is to miss the mark. I totally blew it. I was aimed at some, but I missed it. That's sin. Transgression is to violate boundaries. Lord, forgive those who trespass against me, who violated me. Put up a no trespassing sign and you still go in the yard. But iniquity, that's where it is. See, because iniquity means there is a tendency toward a thing. I may not have done the thing, but it's in me to do it. So when you go to the doctor, they read your chart, and they say, listen, now I want you to fill out this paperwork. Tell me, did your mother have high blood pressure? Did your father have high blood pressure? Because if they had it, you have a tendency. See, people who are just in iniquity, they are very judgmental on people who sin and who trespass. Because sinners and trespassers are people who actually act out on it. So you say, shame on you. You ought to come down and repent. You don't realize, people, that with iniquity, you're just one person away. You already bending that way. I know you shout and dance, but the truth is you just ain't met the right person that could bring out of you what's in you. I'm going to preach this anyhow. You don't have to say amen. Touch your neighbor and say, it's in you. It's in you. There's some stuff in you. You know. And all the devil needs is the right time. Because he takes what you taste, packages it in temptation, knows your tendency, and he waits for the right time to set you up. He waits until you are at your most vulnerable point. Think it's amazing. Look, it's amazing. There's a revelation. Jesus was human and God at the same time. So the revelation has to be in his human sense and in the spiritual sense. It is in Matthew 4. The Bible says when he had fasted 40 days and was hungry, then Satan came to tempt him. Satan could have come at any time, but he waited until he was hungry. When he was at his most vulnerable point, Satan came in. He came to Eve when she was at her most vulnerable point because Adam was out of place. Think about it. When you're at your most vulnerable, that's why you got to be careful sometimes when you come. Well, if your spirituality is like up and down and up and down and up and down, because there's some people you got to be careful when you work in ministry, when you do things for God, and oftentimes you go to these incredible spiritual highs, and then when you get through pouring out and you by yourself, you wonder why you're so vulnerable, why you're so gullible. It's because you stay on the mountain, then you come down, you have nobody to pour into you, and if nobody's pouring into you, you find yourself empty, and then you're sitting around vulnerable and gullible, and that's why you got to ask God, Lord, don't give me moments. I need momentum. I'm tired of going up and down. Give me something that can keep me at 2 o'clock in the morning. Give me something that can keep me when I'm on the road doing what God called me to do. I'm going to preach you anyhow. You wish for the right time. My friend Jeffrey Johnson, watch this. This is going to bless. Told me that in Indianapolis, they had this new law they just passed. First, the law was that the dogs, when they would hunt, and the hunters would hunt, the dogs could no longer go after the wounded deer. It was against the law, so the hunters would shoot the game. They'd have to go and trace the blood themselves and go and find the game. It would take them, you know, hours to find it, take them a long time to find it. Now, they passed a law that now dogs can track wounded deer. So they shoot the game, and they just send the dog out for the game. And in the headlines in the Indianapolis paper, it said, dogs track wounded deer. He and I both got some preaching out of that. Dogs track wounded deer. Dogs track wounded deer. See, when the devil shows up, he knows where to come. When you're wounded and all broken, that's why you end up attracting the kind of folk you attract. Because dogs track wounded deer. When you hold and got the word in you and anointed the devil, like, oh, don't even try about that. Go over here. Because dogs know who to go after. That's why I don't ask God just for healing. I want wholeness. Jesus told the woman with the issue of blood, your faith has made you. So what I got to do? The devil, he is aggressive. He is determined to get the victory over your life, and he has a systematic plan to do it. He wants you to operate in carnality, because if you're not in the spirit, if you stay in your flesh, then you are open now to communication. Remember, when the devil comes, he always comes talking. The devil always comes talking. Psst, psst. That's how he started out in Genesis 3. The serpent was most subtle, and when the serpent saw Eve, said, psst, let me holler at you. Psst, let me holler at you. The devil always comes talking. Delilah got Eve because she talked to him. Put him on her lap and talk from him. Talk to him. Words. See, in this technological society, the devil now has more avenues to talk to us. Has more avenues, so it becomes increasingly difficult to say no, because you got to say no at too many levels. Used to be a time. All you had was a home phone. So if you wasn't home, folk just didn't even have an answering machine. Folk just missed you. So you would get the victory just by proxy. You thank God, hey, I just got the victory the way I can get it. I wasn't there. You call me, but see, now you got a home phone, cell phone, email, two-way. So if they miss you at home, they'll try you on your cell phone. Miss you on your cell phone, they'll text you. Miss you there, they'll send you an email, two-way. So now you got to say no, no, text no, email no. No. See, because the devil uses words, and he wants to keep talking. That's why you got to be careful who you open up your spirit to, who you let talk to you. Because the devil, you can't out-talk the devil, because the devil loves to talk. And what he does, he always changes the language. And so what he does, he begins to talk. Watch, talk. That word is diction. Where we get the word, watch this, dictionary, book of words, words, diction. Add more words, addiction. Addiction, addiction. So whatever you are addicted addicted to starts talking to you. Inanimate objects now talking to you. Liquor talking to you. Dope talking to you. Come on, talk to me, somebody. You know what I'm talking about? And so what you got to do, the devil is trying to get you in a spirit of confusion. Well, you become so confused, you don't know what to do. But somebody has to draw a line in the sand and say, devil, you are not going to have me confused about my purpose, about my sexuality, about my spirituality, about my role. God is not the author of confusion. He's the author of peace. So the complication of the devil is that he comes in so many complex ways. Unless I'm aware of how he's coming, I never can defeat him. See, so now I got to understand that there has to be conviction in my decision. See, I cannot control my choices, but I can control the decisions I make. Remember now, listen carefully what decisions are. Quality choices to act in a deliberate manner to accomplish a predetermined objective. That I make a decision based on my objective, where I'm trying to go. I'm telling you no based on where I'm trying to go. I make a decision based on my objectives in my life. And I got to realize something. I got to get every ounce of pain and future pain out of my life. I got to see drama when it's coming my way. It's all about my ability to abstain. You see, you got to understand something. The devil ain't playing with you. When you say no, you got to have conviction in your no. You can't be talking about, you ought to quit. Stop. Go on now. No, devil ain't playing with you. Because you saying no, but everything in you saying yes. You got to learn the power to abstain. See, you got to know something. Listen, with every choice you make, there are consequences attached. Every choice I make, consequences. Choice to get up, choice to stay in the bed. Choice to work out, choice not to work out. Choice to eat baked, choice to eat fried. Choice to give you my number, choice to say no. Heck no. Heck to the no. They're choices. And every decision has consequences. And then I got the right to choose, but not the right to determine the consequences. I can choose, but I can't control the consequences. You got the right, you can go choose any jacked up relationship you want, but you can't control the consequences. God is like, uh-uh. You chose it, deal with the consequences. I'm not going to bless your mess. Every righteous choice you make, though, will be challenged by the devil. That's how you know you made the right choice, because the devil will try to challenge it. And then the choice you make to live your life for God is the choice that gives purpose and meaning to your life. So when I abstain from the enemy, watch this, that I make up in my mind. I want you to say this with me. What God has in my life is far greater than short-term satisfaction. So I want you to get this. All it takes, newsflash, all it takes is 3 seconds to derail your destiny. 3 seconds in the wrong drink. 3 seconds in the wrong smoke. One snort, 3 seconds. One ride in the car with the wrong people. One act of unprotected sex. One moment of anger out of control. All it took, and what? You took 5 and 10 and 20 years to build up, can all come tumbling down in. See, that's why you need some help saying no. See, because when you say no, the devil going to say, you don't mean it, you tripping. Come on now, why are you tripping? You tell, no, I ain't tripping because I got too much word in me. When I say no, I got conviction in my no. My decision is not based on emotion. My decision is based on the word of God that changes not. And that's why you ought to thank God for the word, because now unto him who's able to keep you from falling, when you got the word of God and folks say, you tripping, why are you tripping? Why are you saying no? I'll tell you why I'm saying no, because no good thing will he withhold from me if I walk upright. No, why are you tripping? I'll tell you why I'm tripping, because there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Why are you tripping? I'll tell you why I'm saying no, because the wages of sin is death, and the gift of God is eternal life. So when you ask me to do crazy stuff, the only thing I'm hearing in my spirit is, would you like to go to hell with me? No! If you could just program your spirit to say, anytime somebody comes to you with something crazy, just start hearing, would you like to go to hell with me? No! Some of y'all gonna be hearing that in the parking lot. Hey, can I get that number? Would you like to go to hell with me? No, 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 no. Because see, what I want is, I want to be attentive. See, watch this. Watch this. Here, bless you. You got to understand the power of keeping your attention on the things of God, being focused, because faithfulness is a result of focus. An idle mind is the devil's workshop. You see, I already know, say for me, in the natural, I already know that I have ADHD. I've already accepted it. I already know. Okay, I'm not in denial. Okay, I know that. My staff knows it. People come meet with me, they brief them. You got a 15-minute meeting with Bishop, but if you don't get it out in the first 6 minutes, you lost him. So they know that. So see, but some of y'all laughing at me, but see, you got ADHD in the spirit. Some of your minds, you sitting in church, you can't stay focused. Because the devil messes with your mind. It wanders so easily. Isn't it amazing? My friends, you know, we do these four services, sometimes five on Sunday. And you know, I get to this, I start at 7 in the morning. And by 12, you know, 45, we done. I'm at the restaurant at 1 o'clock, 1:15, sitting down eating. I'm texting my friends around the city, around the country. Hey, man, what you doing? You know, it's 1 o'clock here, 2 o'clock on the East Coast, texting them. I'm just getting ready to go preach, man, the choir on this second song. I'm like, Doc, what time is it? You just now getting up to preach? And I joke with him, I say, man, listen, man, we in a generation now, man. Them days of 3 and 4 hour church service on Sunday morning are over, man. I'm gonna tell you something, bro. They sit now, but they ain't there. They checked out an hour and a half ago. Some of y'all remember them services, you didn't know what time they were gonna start and what time they were gonna end. You start body left and be out by 3:34. Somebody will say, thank God for deliverance, thank God for deliverance. Some, we thought the Holy Spirit needed all that time to do something. We thought it was going to make us better, and it didn't make us better, because the Holy Spirit don't need all that time to do that. Listen, here's the deal. So you got to get this. The devil is competing for your attention. And God told me to tell somebody, you got to have conviction. Remember Psalm 1? Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, stands in the way of sinners, sits in the seat. Watch what happens. He makes a conscious decision to make decisions away from negative influences, but yet he now becomes a worshiper. He meditates on the word day and night. He shifts his focus, and now he's a worshiper. You know why the devil hates worship? Because worship takes the attention off of him. The devil hated worship. That's how he got kicked out of heaven, because he said there ought to be term limits up here. Somebody else ought to be getting the glory, but you, God. God says, I will not share my glory with nobody. You and all y'all get up out of here. Because God sits on the throne. So when you are a worshiper, what you are declaring, you are saying, listen, I am not distracted by my circumstances. I am not distracted by any demonic attack. I am in the very presence of God. And it doesn't matter what's going on. When I'm a worshiper, worship can save you from some stuff. When you're a worshiper, man, it becomes like an alibi for you. I ask my friends in the legal profession, I say, man, what's an alibi? I know what it is, but what is it really? They say, well, I tell you, alibi is the claim or proof that when an alleged act has taken place, one was somewhere else. I said, that'll preach. But a claim or proof of an alleged act has taken place that one was somewhere else, That means that when the devil comes and says, yeah, I know you were there. I said, no, I wasn't there. Where were you? I was worshiping. I was in a whole nother place. See, some folk don't even realize that while they're trying to seduce you and get you caught up in the stuff, when you get in the presence of God, you're in a whole nother place. You're in a whole nother spiritual zip code. Am I talking to any worshipers in here that at any moment you can just get caught up in the very presence of God? Okay, now watch this. Watch this. I want you to get this. I want you to see the power of no practically. Now, the way I end this message, don't miss it, because this is really about who's going to control your destiny. Listen. Destiny is in decisions. God told me to tell somebody that your destiny lies in your next decision. Some of you got some major decisions to make, but listen carefully. How your life ends up can be in your next decision. And some of you have some major choices, but remember, either your destiny is going to be in the hands of God or your destiny is going to be in the hands of the enemy. Now listen, what you got to do is you got to walk around with some authority. I am not a wimp. I am not going to walk around living beneath what God has promised my life. If I'm going to have authority, what that means is I take authority over the devil. I'm not going to sit around and gloat on the devil talking about how he's running in my life and I'm going through the devil just attacking me. All you doing is lifting up the devil. Something inside of you ought to say, devil, you will not have my family. You're not going to have my future. And I'm not codependent on somebody else to come slap me with oil, lay hands on me. I got enough authority. I can walk through my own house, lay hands on my own children, anoint my own head, lay hands on myself. Somebody shout authority. When you understand your authority, you also say, wait a minute, you say, I'm anointed. I'm not anybody. Devil, you just ain't gonna step to me any kind of way. I'm God's anointed. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm God's anointed. I will not be pushed around. You will not go run in and up out of my house. God saves his anointed. And the anointing on my life means that God fights my battles. The anointing on my life declares no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Somebody shout, I'm anointed. The reason why I'm able to get out of the stuff I get in is because of the anointing on my life. People don't like me, don't have to like me, but one thing they can't deny is when I am anointed, I walk in the authority and power under the Holy Spirit. Then I'm able to abide. I have too much purpose. Listen, don't miss this. I have too much purpose, too much destiny on my life to be uprooted from where I am. Here it is. No. No. Listen. No. No. No, you're not going to have my family. No. No. You're not going to have my children. No. You're not going to have my ministry. No. No, I'm not just saying it, Satan. I want you to know something. No, you're not going to take me through the drama I went through last year. No. No, I'm not putting up with your mess this year. No. No, I'm not compromising my integrity. No. What, you don't get it? You don't understand? No. Well, what, do I have to speak in another language? You know what? If you were French, I'd say noon. If you were Spanish, I'd say no. If you were German, I would say nien. If you were Hungarian, I would say nahin. If you were Latin, I'd say nulus. If you were Zulu, I would say tasha. If you were Hebrew, I'd say lo. And if you from the hood, no. Look at somebody, tell them no. And let that devil know you're not gonna have what God promised me. Oh, look at somebody and tell them I'm gonna be where God wants me to be. I'm gonna have what God wants me to have. I'm declaring over my life no to every attack of the enemy, every lie of the enemy, everything the enemy tries to bring in my life.
I'm done. No. Thank you.
I'm done. You know what the Bible says? Listen. The Bible says that you will resist the devil. Watch the authority. He'll run from you. I wish you stopped running from him. I really do. I wish you just stop running from the devil. Walk up in there and say, I'm God's anointed. Now, one of us gonna leave, and guess who ain't going nowhere? The Bible says that if you put on the whole armor of God, you may be able to stand the wiles of the enemy. That, those are the schemes, the tactics. But watch this. After having done all, stand. You know who I'm looking at right now? I'm looking at people in this place today who are standing. It's not because they ain't been through some stuff. It's not because the enemy hadn't come. But it's because they made up in their mind, devil, no, you're not going to break me. Devil, no, I'm not going to lose my mind. I may be down to the bottom, but I know God is still the rock I'm standing on. No!
Looking for some inspirational gospel content? Just subscribe to Brother Rollins' YouTube channel today. We post the most motivational and preaching videos and gospel songs that are sure to get you through any situation. Even better, we have also launched a new apparel store that gives you access to a wide range of high-quality items. From awesome tees to hoodies, sweatshirts, mugs, and even tote bags, you can now proclaim your faith wherever you go and support our YouTube channel. Just visit the Brother Rollins YouTube channel and click on the store tab to shop now.